Shauna and I will not be seen tonight so that we may bring you the following KOMO special presentation.
Like that eclipse, and I said it couldn't cloud up that quick, so I walked out and looked, and I seen that big black cloud a-rolling, and then the feeling I had was just like there was a little kid out there in the car about to run over it, and you couldn't help him.
I'm walking towards the only light I can see on top of a ridge. I can hear the mountain behind me rumbling. It's an enormous mud and water, so I came down and washed out the road. I never really thought I'd believe this or say this, but at this moment, I honest to God believe I'm dead.
You know, when the mountain went that day, all the stuff you see around you, there's just tons and tons of rock and mud. I saw this coming down the valley behind me. I really had to run from it, try to get away from it. And, yes, just looking at it, it's definitely an uneasy feeling.
Oh, dear God. My God, this is hell. I just can't describe it. It's pitch black. Just pitch black. This is hell on earth I'm walking through. Oh, God. One step at a time, if I can just keep walking.
You survived. Does that give you any stronger will, a sense of, I survived this, I can survive anything?
No, I think it's just the opposite, really. The woods being outside, it's just always seemed like a nice, warm, safe place to be. It's the thing I really enjoy doing. After seeing this, I guess I really realized my frailty, I guess you'd say.
Everybody was afraid, and we always have a, well, even to this day, we still have one bag packed all the time.
Today, exactly 1 year after the explosive eruption of Mount St. Helens, an uneasy calm surrounds the mountain. The volcano is still active. Steam and ash still spew from the crater. An earthquake shake the countryside. Yet somehow, it all seems tame compared to the dramatic events of a year ago.
Eruption jitters seem to have given way to souvenir sales.
Helens, Helens, now St. Helens.
Pomp of Pompeii fully fadeth anon, when the mystery cloak of the Smokies hath gone, when the Alps and the Pyrenees...
T-shirts, movies, even ash earrings have helped turn Mount St. Helens into a historical oddity, a tourist attraction, the stuff of which folk legends and games are made.
Mount St. Helens, 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 Mount St. Helens.
Boom, 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 boom.
Dip, 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 dip.
Helens, Helens, Mount St. Helens.
But to the people who continue to live and work in the shadow of the mountain, in the once peaceful valley towns of Tootle, Kid Valley, and Maple Flats, the eruption of May 18th, 1980, holds no glamour. On that day, their lives changed forever.
we lost everything that was, you know, valuable to us that we hadn't taken out of the house, which was very minimal.
Has always been home is not home anymore. I mean, it's just like having a nuclear blast that you can't go into anymore.
People along the Toodle River Valley lost friends and family. They lost homes and possessions. And perhaps peace of mind. The eruption shattered all that. But it didn't shatter their will to hang on. It's a toughness born of knowing that they're part of that mountain, that it's in their heart and veins. That they will survive.
Great events make great people. The greatest are those who endure, like Dale and Judy Hoy of Toodle. The mountain took their son from them, but not their spirit to keep living. Violet and Harry McNutt, the mountain almost took their home. A year later, they are still digging out so they can return. And Sheriff Les Nelson, who never dreamed his biggest fight would be against a mountain.
I think that it'll be years before we really know what the impact of all of this means to the people that lived here. Well, it's somewhat depressing, but life does go on. It's just different, and will be from this day forth. What is known as Toodle Park Road through here. The houses were totally devastated. There must have been 20 or 30 homes at least up along here that just no longer exist. There were house trailers and cars and everything wrapped around trees. Some houses just gone.
When Les Nelson hired on as sheriff of Cowlitz County, one of the things he never dreamed he'd have to deal with was an active volcano in his own backyard.
There wasn't anything about a volcano in my job description when I took over as sheriff here.
But when the mountain blew, a large portion of Sheriff Nelson's county was right in the middle of the mud flows that came crashing down the mountain. The north and south forks of the Toodle River ballooned from 20-foot-wide streams to mile-wide torrents filled with trees, cars, logging trucks, and mud. Houses built along the river didn't stand a chance.
I don't know how many people have ever come in, had an opportunity to come in and look at this mess. There's the foundation of the house. Everything was swept away. The way we never found even so much as a single board of that house. All the possessions, it was as though you would go somewhere and simply return home and have nothing but the clothes on your back. And that's what happened to a lot of people, particularly this family. There was nothing left here, completely swept away.
Now, a full year later, mud lines still mark the trees, graphic evidence of nature's terrible, uncontrollable power, a power Sheriff Nelson has learned to respect and plan against. Few doubt that it could happen again, and Sheriff Nelson wants to be ready.
The mountain's going to do something at least one more time. And I don't have any scientific data to base that on. It's just the feeling that I have one more time around, probably we will have some kind of an event. No one knows whether it'll be big or small. I'm comfortable when the mountain's steaming off. It's kind of like the pressure cooker on your stove. It's when it quits, so that's when I get disturbed.
We've seen the awesome scope of destruction here time after time on our TV sets. Yet in the comfort of home, in the safety of seeing it all from a distance, it's impossible to understand the power, to feel the fury unleashed here. Yet the residents of the Toodle Valley are reminded of this power and this fury every day of their lives. They drive by all of this, and they know it can happen again. So you begin to ask yourself, why do they stay? And how do they cope with the uneasiness that surrounds them?
I would have to admit that it did occur to us that maybe we should just walk away and forget it, but after we thought it over and everything and decided that it was still worth saving, so we just started digging in.
For Harry and Violet McNutt of Tower Road, it's taken all of this past year just to dig out the dream house they were building for their retirement. The McNutts were luckier than most of their neighbors. Their house withstood the pressure of the 8-foot-high wall of mud that smothered the area. Most of the major property damage occurred here along the North Fork of the Toutle River, but that hasn't discouraged the McNutts from going back to the place they call home.
This is where we want to live, and we just want to stay here. We're just going to hang right in here. And, I look for more people to come back from time to time and rebuild, and I think it'll come back eventually to like it used to be, which was probably one of the prettiest rivers in the United States as far as I was concerned.
Back to what it used to be. Residents along the Toutle know that will take years, perhaps a lifetime, before the physical beauty of their country returns.
A big part of our life was tied up in that area.
For Dale Hoy of Toutle, it's been a year of struggling, not only with the loss of the land, but with the loss of his son.
We lost our son after the mountain blew, our 17-year-old boy, and it was directly related to the mountain. Now I, if it's possible, I hate the mountain. Maybe it's bitterness, I don't know. It used to be when I drove home from work every night, you'd come up over the top of the hill and you could look at the mountain as you drove home, and it was a thing that I always did, you know, on the way home. But now, after everything that's happened, I don't even look at it anymore. When we drive by the lake or over the top of the hill, I look at the road. Maybe someday it'll be all right. But for now, just don't care for it.
The trauma suffered on May 18th has drawn the people of Toutle even closer together.
Okay. Where did you put the packets?
Neighborhood get-togethers, like this one at Dale and Judy Hoy's, are frequent.
No, that's fine. That's fine right there.
For a moment or two, they can put the problems of living underneath a volcano behind them. For a moment or two, life returns to normal.
Is that his hat?
Hi, neighbor.
Hi.
Jump right in there.
Get some meat. Quinn, please don't.
Got apples and oranges.
I worry all the time about what could happen, but yet our ties are here. And because we all care for each other, I think that's why we all are staying. I think if we were isolated, people wouldn't help each other. That there'd be more people leaving than there is. We've lost a few, but the majority of the people have stayed. And I think that's why.
It's easier now to laugh, to sing. But the people here never forget what happened a year ago, and they refuse to be lulled into a false sense of complacency about their mountain.
You don't put that mountain in a box. That's nature, God, whatever you want to call it. That's when it's going to do whatever it wants to do and whenever it wants to do it, and there's nothing anybody can do about it. The best thing I can think of is you be prepared for the worst and hope for the best.
Darling,
has been good to the mountain. Nature and the changing seasons have helped heal many of the scars left by the eruption a year ago. Time has been better to Mount St. Helens than it has been to the people who still live in its shadow. Their scars still show. The strain, your whole life, everything you've worked for destroyed in a few minutes. Nagging uncertainty.
This is all subjective. Maybe it won't happen. Maybe it will happen. Of course, a year ago, I couldn't conceive of what has happened down here now.
The fears that it can happen again.
What we went through, I think that's about as bad as things can get. And hopefully nothing ever happens again. You know. So. But we never know about the mountain.
Some of the resident mathematicians have calculated 94 feet of water over right where we're sitting. So, that,
does it scare you?
No. Not at all. There's a hill right up here that I'll have the family and the wife up there before you can say scat, I can guarantee you that.
The wonder if the warning will come in time.
There is no warning system here. There's no adequate warning system in Tootle.
As far as I understand it now, today, the evacuation procedure is exactly the same. They're going to send squad cars from Longview, which, again, is 30 minutes away. And depending on how much time we would have, would regulate whether we get in or out here or not. So, we have no way of knowing.
Will they make it out in time? That's one question that has haunted residents all year long.
You're going to have to go, and the faster the better. One time, one thing, you got to go.
Last year, there simply wasn't time to develop anything more than the Paul Revere-type house-to-house warning plan. Luckily, it worked, especially since most people underestimated the volcano's wrath. But now, a year has passed. The power of the volcano has been demonstrated, and the people here have a hard time understanding why a more sophisticated sensor warning system hasn't been installed. Could more be done to protect the people of Tootle? We put that question to Rick LaValla of the State's Department of Emergency Services.
Rick, if you lived up in the Tootle area, would you feel safe and secure with the systems in place? Do you think the state would be able to protect your life if you were a resident there?
Oh, boy, that's a hard question. Obviously, I don't think that any kind of a warning system that exists today, even if we went out and bought one, is going to give you 100%. Adequate warning. There's problems with every individual receiving warning. Certainly on May 18, the Paul Revere warning system that existed that day did work. The same system with some modifications as it exists today. I know that one of their concerns, of course, would be for a better warning system, perhaps some sort of remote sensing that would trigger some devices to set off sirens or alarms. Obviously, we concur. That would be optimum. Where the money's going to come from, that's been debated now for many months.
Whose fault is that? Where's the money supposed to come from, and why hasn't it been spent?
That's a good question. The question is always, where does the money come from? Local people have a certain perspective that as soon as they get into trouble or that there's some unusual event that happens, that they can turn to the next level of government and that somehow there exists a magical pot of money that's just going to bail them out. The fact is that there's no dedicated funding. The answers probably are with the local elected officials and the people that we elect to go to the legislature. I would think there's some answers there.
But can the people of Tootle afford to wait? The mountain today is just as active, dangerous, and unpredictable as it was a year ago. More than 60 people were killed during the eruption May 18th, a Sunday morning when logging camps were closed. Most of the dead were campers who went around roadblocks to get to the mountain. But what will happen if the next blast takes place during the week, in the middle of the tourist season, or when thousands of loggers are on the mountain and millions of sightseers clog the roadways? The locals are concerned.
The tourism problem is going to be another experience like the flood, only it's going to be a flood of people, I'm afraid. Comes that time and the pressure gets to a certain point, I'll do the same thing that I did last time. I'll just close the roads and kick them out.
You get that many tourists here, and if something should happen, there'd be no way we could get out, let alone the tourists couldn't get out and we couldn't get out either. And coming up here, they're not going to see anything. I think they all think they're going to be able to just drive to the mountain, but that's not the way it is.
The people of Mount St. Helens cannot turn their backs on the mountain. They cannot depend on just promises. So they wait and watch the mountain and the rivers, looking for danger signals, changing currents, heavy silt deposits, earthquakes. For the land is what they know best. Perhaps they know the mountain better than all the experts who have surrounded Mount St. Helens. The people of Mount St. Helens have built lives, families, and futures here. Their roots are too deep to leave, despite the nightmare of it all.
You're a young man. How would you feel if you were me and knowing that everything that you'd worked for could just be destroyed in just a few minutes? When you've put your whole life into an area and you've built your house out of the rocks that came from the mountain and you put your whole life in here, naturally there's a strain, because I have problem living with the thought, but I have a little bit of problem disposing with the property that I own here. Unless you have $1 million to buy me out today, I think I'll have to stay here.
On the mountain, snow hides much of the deadly gray hue left by the ash of a year ago. Greens and yellows dot the once barren landscape. Even wildlife begins its return to the mountain. And as the mountain begins to rebuild, so do the people. There is a sense of renewal and of hope.
I think that if a person could live long enough, it'll probably be pretty again. And I purposely, you know, try to remember the way the mountain looked and the way the high country around the mountain looked.
Memories play an important part in all our lives. Yet for the people who call the mountain home, memories may be the only things they have left. Lazy afternoons fishing the Tootle River, gone. Vacations spent on the mountain, gone. Even the daily peace and quiet of their lives here, all gone. Memories of the joy the mountain brought are all that remain. And yet, maybe, that's what keeps these people going day to day. The joy of remembering the way life here used to be. The strength in believing that someday, for their children or their grandchildren, that joy will return.